Now, before I proceed, this is a real interesting study in regard to, I should say, the correlation. Not saying it's a causal argument, and the researchers don't want to say that either. Hence, this is a pilot study, so you have to check for what's called other confounding factors, biases that may creep into the study somehow. However, through correlation, the reduction of MSG, or potentially the removal of MSG from the diet, within a two-week period of time, resulted in a significant 30% or greater drop in the severity of pain in these particular subjects themselves. So 2 weeks, 30% reduction correlated with the removal of MSG from the diet, as well as a little hydration on top of that. You'll understand why in a second. But to proceed with the study as follows. Title of the study is Pilot Study in Kenya Shows Link Between Chronic Pain and Glutamate Consumption. Researchers test theory that diet change can alleviate pain. Why Kenya? Well, part of the reason being, too, is in the United States, MSG goes under a ton of different names and has a large variety of foods contain MSG. So even if study participants were trying to avoid MSG, it could be disguised, I shouldn't say disguised, I should say classified as something else in regards to the ingredients such as hydrolyzed protein. With Kenya, even though the consumption of MSG may be high, the source of MSG were limited and then henceforth easier to control for the pilot study. To proceed, preliminary research from a small pilot study carried out in Meru, in eastern Kenya, I hope I pronounced that correctly, shows a link between chronic pain and consumption of glutamate, a common flavor enhancer found in Western and non-Western diets worldwide, meaning everywhere. Results demonstrated that when study participants cut monosodium glutamate from their diets, their symptoms improved, the findings published in the Journal of Nutrition. To move forward, this preliminary research in Kenya is consistent, this is just quoted the researcher per se narrating, with what I am observing in my chronic pain researcher here in the United States, said Kathleen Holton. We don't know what exposure is leading to the susceptibility of dietary glutamate. Key word there, leading to susceptibility of dietary glutamate. Other illnesses, why are they so sensitive to it? And why do they respond so well when it's removed from the diet? To proceed, but this pilot study suggests a need for a large-scale clinical trial since dietary change could be an effective low-cost treatment option for developing countries. I don't know why not here either, but just the same. Now, this is the list in regard to the clip that they say in regard to the foods. As you could see and you read through there, it gives you a brief summary of all a few of the names that MSG is also classified under in the United States as far as how common it is too. Now, in regard to the study itself, there's one very popular spice in this particular area of Kenya, which I am not going to say, per se, for legal reasons. However, when they switched this spice out with an alternative spice with no MSG, then the results, as we shall explain, followed. Now to move on. Study participants experienced chronic pain for at least 3 months or more in at least three quadrants of the body, similar to what is seen with widespread pain patients in the United States. Most also suffered from other neurological symptoms, including headaches, migraines, chronic fatigue, cognitive dysfunction, and sleep issues. Now, those are other potential outcomes in regard to alleviating MSG that were not looked into the study. We're just looking at chronic pain. To proceed. This research came out of, I hope I pronounced this name appropriately, CLAW, when they learned about Meru's villagers' plight with chronic pain. When the team initially surveyed residents in the area, an estimated 60% reported chronic pain, twice the amount typically observed. With that in mind, we're going to go straight into the abstract itself. Now, they had different groups. Some consumed water, some consumed water with MSG, some consumed water without MSG, blah, blah, blah. Let's proceed forward. Basically, groups received one, water, two, alternative spices without MSG, three, water and alternative spices, meaning with MSG, four, acetaminophen, 1,000 milligrams twice daily for those with neither exposure, improvement as defined as greater than 30% reduction in pain impact scores. I'm going to read that one more time. For those with neither exposure. All right. Improvement was defined as a greater than or equal to 30% reduction in pain impact scores. Now, we're only talking 2 weeks, which is just fascinating. But to proceed further, the results. Prevalence of chronic pain among the 89 subjects surveyed was 60%. 30 subjects were recruited for the intervention. 90% female average, The water in alternative spices and acetaminophen groups both experienced significant reductions in pain after 2 weeks. So the water and alternative spices, the group without MSG, as well as the acetaminophen group, both obviously noticed a significant reduction in pain after 2 weeks. Now, who is the winner? Let us proceed. With the greatest percentage of subjects improving in the water and alternative spices group, meaning alternative spice that was replaced that had no MSG in it. Fascinating results. Now, to go into the highlights real fast before we go into the conclusion. All right, highlights. Kenya may have a higher chronic pain prevalence in other countries studied to date. Just reading through the highlights. Dietary changes may significantly reduce the impact of widespread chronic pain, such as the reduction or removal of MSG from the diet. Correlation-wise, MSG may modulate pain neurotransmission via altered glutamatergic neurotransmission. That's the hypothesis that was introduced by the research itself. Further studies need to be done. But so what they're saying basically, it enhances pain somehow. All right, to look to the conclusion. The pilot data suggests an abnormally high prevalence of pain in Meru, Kenya, and that MSG intake combined with dehydration may be contributing to chronic widespread pain in this region. Future research should be included, formal pain prevalence estimate, and a randomized controlled trial to further test this dietary intervention. Meaning the researchers were most impressed correlation-wise. Again, I keep on emphasizing that word, and I'm trying not to fall into using the word causal. Correlation-wise, such an incredibly simple, easy dietary intervention resulting in a significant drop in pain of greater than 30% after a two-week period of time, surpassing that of those taking 2 grams of acetaminophen per day, is just astounding. Now, obviously, they're utilizing this in regard to the pilot study in Kenya, but you know what? If you have with the supervision of your medical practitioner, you know, just a disclaimer part, it may be something worth a try here. For so many suffering chronic pain, just looking at source of MSG, see if it correlates to the same results as resulted in this pilot study here. Again, this is Ralph Turciano signing off. Once again, look forward to see you all in 7 days. DUI citation, everything there will be linked so you can follow the study and read on your own. And as always, I appreciate you listening. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We'll catch you next week. Bye.